the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphans our sons and daughters? The King of glory, the King above all kings. The nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb who was slain,
worthy is the Lamb who was slain,
worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
You do, Father. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. You know, Lord, as we start the service this rainy Wednesday evening, Lord, we pray that you would just open the heavens and pour out upon this dry state rain. Yes. Somebody's excited about rain, Lord. Lord, we need it. But Father, as we are gathering, so many of our fellowship tonight are sick. You know, we think of Scott and Donna and several others who've called in, and some are traveling, some are out of state, some are moving, and just a lot of things going on. And, you know, we pray for them. We pray, Lord, that you would just rejuvenate them, that you would strengthen them, Father, as they're doing whatever it is they need to do or healing up from whatever it is they're sick from, Lord. We pray for them. We want to pray for Tracy, who had an emergency call and had to go to the airport tonight and fly down to Southern California to be with her mom. Just a lot of things going on. But Lord, for us here this evening, as we just settle in, open our hearts to what it is you have for us, as we have another opportunity to worship and express to you, Father, how much we thank you as we come now to Leviticus chapter 4 and 5 and we see that you have made provision for our sin and trespass. You know, Lord, we are a thankful and a grateful people. So, Father, fill this place with your presence tonight, we pray. Move upon our hearts, we ask. Wash us and cleanse us from our sin. We employ you, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's kids that say, amen. Hey, let's remain standing.
You spread out the skies over empty space, said, let there be light to a dark and formless world. Your light was born. You spread out your arms over empty hearts, said, let there be light to a dark and hopeless world. Your son was born. He made the world, saw that he was good. He sent your only son, for you are good. What a wonderful maker, what a wonderful savior, how majestic your whispers, how humble your love, with a strength like no other, and a heart of a father. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. No eye has fully seen how beautiful the cross, and we have only heard the faintest whispers of how great you are. You made the world. You made the world. Saw that it was good. You sent your only son, for you are good. You are, what a wonderful maker. What a wonderful Savior. How majestic your whispers. How humble your love. With a strength like no other. And a heart of a father. Majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. You made the world. You made the world. Saw that it was good. You sent your only son, for you are good. What a wonderful maker.
Wonderful maker.
What a wonderful Savior.
Wonderful Savior.
How majestic your whispers.
Wonderful God.
How humble your love. With a strength like no other.
Wonderful Father.
And the heart of a father. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. Lord, we thank you that you have the heart of a father. The same way, Lord, that you have given us the ability, Lord, to love our children and what we would do for them, Lord. And how much more you love us. And Lord, that verse, how majestic your whispers. But Lord, it's in the stillness that we hear. Lord, help us to be still and to know that you are God. Knowing that if you are for us, who can be against us? Doesn't matter truly what the tide looks like, for you are in complete control. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, for thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose. Here am I,
here am I,
all of me,
all of me.
Take my life,
take my life,
it's all for thee,
all for thee.
Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own, it shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour, at your feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Here am I,
here am I,
all of me,
all of me.
Take my life,
take my life,
it's all for thee,
all for thee.
Here am I,
here am I,
all of me,
all of me.
Take my life,
take my life,
It's all for thee.
All for thee.
Here am I.
Here am I.
All of me.
All of me.
Take my life.
Take my life.
It's all for thee.
All for thee.
Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Lord, that is our desire, God. That you would have all of us. Lord, that we wouldn't hold anything in reserve. We would open all the doors of our hearts, God. This is the day of salvation, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Thousands elsewhere. One thing I ask and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask and I would seek, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water to my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. One day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere, sing it out, church. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day. Thousands elsewhere. Bride, we are gathered here together, ready to rise and to be with you forever. With love in our eyes, we will meet in the sky. Jesus, come, please come. Here is your church, in the power of your Spirit. Give us your word, how we need to hear. You said that you will, oh, but our prayer is still, Jesus, come, please come. Jesus, come, please come. Love stands before us now. The whole earth is reaching out, yearning for your renown. Jesus, come, please come. Jesus, come, please come.
Are you ready, church?
Waiting we long for the glory of your presence. Standing in awe as we worship you in reverence. We will arrive because you are alive. Jesus, come, please come. Love stands before us now. The whole earth is reaching out, yearning for your renown. Jesus, come, please come. Jesus, come, please come. Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed in my life. In my life.
Let that be your prayer, church.
Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed in my life, in my life. Love stands before us now. The whole earth is reaching out, yearning for your renown. Jesus, come, please come. Jesus, come, please come. Love stands before us now. The whole earth is reaching out, yearning for your renown. Jesus, come, please come. Jesus, come, please come. Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed. Let your glory be revealed in my life. In my life. Lord, there's so much stuff that the enemy can throw at us, Lord, that can get us down. But Lord, we thank you, Father, that there's no condemnation in Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you have covered us in robes of righteousness. You have washed us as white as snow. And there's nothing that we can do to add to the cross. There's nothing that we can do to take away from the power of the cross, Lord. It's all the work of Jesus on the cross. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. We thank you that we have the name of Jesus to call upon. Lord, that we can come to the throne of grace boldly. Lord, we love your name. 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 Really hard, church. Lord, we love your name. 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 Your name has made the broken whole, and your name has saved my soul. Your name is all we're living for. Jesus, we love your name. We love your name. Lord, we praise 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 your name. Your name has made the broken whole, and your name has saved my soul. And your name is all we're living for. Jesus, we love your name. Your name has made the broken whole, and your name has save my soul. Your name is all we're living for. Jesus, we love your name. We love your name. We love your name. Your name has made the broken whole, and your name has saved my soul. Your name is all we're living for. Jesus, we love your name. We love your name. Let's sing, Lord, we love your name, one more time. Lord, we love your name. Let's all stand. Lord, we love your name.
We love your name.
Lord, we love your name.
Jesus.
Lord, we love your name. Lord, we praise 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 your name.
You know, Lord, how sweet it has been this evening, just to come and set, and how soothing tonight, for whatever reason, the worship has been. It's just been one of those nights where you just want us to come and set and just unwind and unload. That's what I did anyway, Father. Just thank you. Thank you, Lord. You know, life is stressful, Lord, but we find rest in you. And so, Lord, we just pray tonight for those of our fellowship that aren't here, and many have called in sick. And, you know, Scott and Donna, who are always here, Father, are homesick. We pray for them. You know, Lord, we want to pray for Bill and Tracy. Tracy got a call today, had to run down, as you well know, Father, to be with her mom down in Southern California. Actually fly, she didn't run. Bill had to take her to the airport just at a spur of the moment. And Lord, we just pray that you would give to Tracy an open door to share the gospel with her mom, who from all, you know, signs is not going to live long. And we ask that you would just do that. And pray for Ken and Betty Kay that are celebrating their anniversary. Pray, Lord, just for those that, for whatever reason, couldn't be here. We want to lift them before you, Father. But tonight, Lord, we just pray for those that are here. And Lord, if we've come in here tired or weary, Lord, we just ask that you would just lift us up. Just strengthen us, Lord, for the commitment we've made to come out on a rainy Wednesday night and just sit in your presence and to study your word. So, Lord, we just thank you for all of those things. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's kids that say, amen. We'll spend a few moments greeting one another before you settle back into your spot. Just sit in. Okay. All right, if you guys could settle into your spot. Am I a little loud tonight? Am I loud? No? Okay. If you guys could settle into your spot, man, we'll get going. We're going to talk about sin and trespass tonight. Aren't you glad you came on a rainy Wednesday night to talk about sin and trespass? Aren't you glad? Hey, don't make me ring the bell on a Wednesday night. Come on, guys. Pastor Jason already burned up at least 5 minutes of my time. You know, he gets in the spirit and gets moving, and I'm going to get one of them shot callers that tells him, okay, that's the last song. No, I'll just be quenching you. Oh, man. You know, for whatever reason, it's just, I'm full of it tonight. I'm telling you, so be careful. It just, I got to spend such a rich time this morning. Let me share this before we pray and open the Word. And, you know, this morning was, you know, you have those mornings when you get up early and you get your cup of coffee. And I always like to go sit on the porch, and I've been doing that lately. And this morning was one of those balmy mornings where I literally had to put my sweats on. It was a little cold in a sweatshirt. And just the time that I got to spend with the Lord was so refreshing. You know, started about 6, and I usually go for about an hour, maybe an hour and a half. And then, you know, by 7:30, I got to go in and take a shower. I looked down at my watch, and it was 8:30, and I was in a scramble to get a shower and get to the church. I would encourage you in the times that we're living in, spend time with the Lord. There's nothing that will relieve your stress and take away your fear and your anxiety. There's nothing that will bring more confidence and assurance to your hearts. There's nothing that will rejuvenate you more. My wife, we were chatting, she goes, well, when are you going to go camping? You need to take a week off while I'm gone and go. And you know what? A few mornings like that before the Lord, and I don't need to go anywhere. I just got to thinking, man, I don't need to go anywhere. This front porch is fine. I don't have to get extra food. I don't have to pack anything. I don't have to burn gas. I can just sit right here in the presence of God. And so I just want to encourage you to do that, and how rejuvenating it is. And talking about rejuvenating, we're in Leviticus chapter 4 and 5, and we're going to be talking tonight about sin and transgression. Aren't you glad you just came out on a Wednesday night? You came out on a rainy Wednesday night, left your warm home, got in your cold car, traveled to the church just to hear a message on sin and transgression. Yes. One person said, yes, I need to hear. Well, listen, as we go through our study tonight, and I just want to take my time. I do want to get through chapter 4 and 5 because I don't want to linger long around that subject. But I want you to be greatly encouraged from the Word tonight concerning sin and trespass. I want you to see God's view of it. I want you to see the means by which God has given to us to get rid of it, to be free from it, to be clean and just absolutely washed. You know, so that we don't carry around that guilt and condemnation. You know, one of the things that Pastor Jason said, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. And the word for condemnation in the Greek is katakarim, and it means punishment. You see, some of us think that when we sin, God wants to punish us. You know, like he's this giant ogre in the sky with this giant fly swatter waiting to swat you every time you sin. Nothing could be further from the truth. And that's what is declared as we come now to Leviticus chapter 4 and chapter 5. So let's pray and we'll dive in. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the authority of your word. We thank you that we can have confidence in your word. We thank you that your word is inerrant, inspired, that, Lord, it's God-breathed. We can trust it. We can trust what it says. And tonight, Lord, as we come to this section, as we look at the last two of the five sacrifices that were instituted by God through Moses, that there is great significance in those. And so help us to unpack it tonight. And Lord, I would just pray that you would free your people tonight from any condemnation, from any guilt, from any shame. God does not hate sinners. He hates sin. And we're going to see this evening why he hates sin and why he's made a provision and he's given us a plan by which we can be free from it. And so help us tonight, Lord, we pray, to wrap our hands around it, we ask, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. Did you know that the Bible presupposes that you as a believer are going to sin. Did you know that? What is interesting about the construct of the book of Leviticus is as we come out of Exodus, listen, all of the instruments of worship have been constructed. The tabernacle has been raised. Everything is ready. God now is preparing the Levitical priesthood to minister to his people. And by definition, a priest is one who puts his hand on God and puts his hand on man. There needs to be a bridge, a daysman, if you will. Because God knows that on our best day, we're going to struggle. And so when we come to Leviticus, the first three of those sacrifices that you study there are voluntary. You don't need to do them. You can't perform the last two if you don't perform the first three, but the last two are mandatory. The very first one, the burnt offering, speaks of consecration. We would equate that today in the New Testament is being saved. We come to that place where Christ was sacrificed for our sin. We accept that sacrifice for the payment of our sin, and he gives to us the gift of grace and forgiveness of sin. He fills us with his Spirit. He writes our names in the book of life, and we are born again. The second of those, which is the meal offering, is the offering of our hands, the offering of our service, anything that we could do for the Lord in return for what he's done for us. And the third of those offerings we looked at was the peace offering, and that's the offering of our heart. So we have come to the Lord and we've said, Father, forgive us. We don't want to be alienated from you anymore. We've heard the gospel message and we receive it. We understand the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. He was the burnt offering for our sins. We receive it. And by faith, we ask now that you would make us a son and a daughter of the living God. That's the burnt offering. Out of gratitude, we say, Lord, you have my whole life. Everything I am or ever hope to be, I give to you in service to you. That's the meal offering, the work of the hands. But I don't want to just give you the work of the hands. I want to give you my heart. We looked at that last time we were in Leviticus. That's the peace offering, the inner parts. We offer those secret places to the Lord because it is the heart that God is after. It's not just the head and the hands. It's the heart. And those three are voluntary. And when you do those things, now watch this. The Bible, as we come now to chapter 4 and chapter 5, chapter 4 all the way through chapter 5 to verse 14, he deals with sin. King James is going to call it, sin that you did in ignorance, but really it means unintentional sin. Because doing your best to serve the Lord, you're still going to come short of the glory of God, and there's a way to deal with that. And then when he gets to chapter 5, verse 15, he's going to deal with willful trespass. And listen, the Bible presupposes, here's what I want you to see tonight. The Bible presupposes in its teaching that you are going to have a struggle as a believer in Jesus Christ with sin and trespass. Did you know that? Did you know from the moment you get saved, you enter into now this arena, you enter now into this realm, if you will, where you have an enemy and you're involved in a spiritual battle. And there's a way to be victorious. And there's times when you're not going to be victorious. And that's what chapter 4 and chapter 5 are about. Let me share with you before we get into that. Because in chapter 4, when it comes to the sin offerings, on into the mid part of chapter 5, there are four types of people that need to come before the Lord and offer a sin offering. First, the priest, we're going to see tonight. And then the whole congregation. And that particular sin offering that they're to offer is different. You're going to see tonight. It's different from the sin offering that the rulers, the people who are involved in civil government, when they sin, or the common man has to offer. Four different people are mentioned and types of people when sin is involved, what they need to do to come to get it cleansed, to get it removed, to get forgiveness. There's a great reminder in chapter 4 of what sin really is, what it really does. And then when we get into chapter 5, we have the trespass offering, those things that we do willfully. And by the way, Christians do sin willfully. Knowing that the line is there as an act of your will, you'll step across it sometimes. It's not unintentional. It's an act of rebellion, and sometimes we do that. So here's what I want you to see tonight. Listen carefully as we go through this study. The Bible presupposes that after you have consecrated your life to Christ, after you've given Him your service and your heart, there's a battle you're going to be in. There's a struggle that you're going to have with sin, with Satan, with the world, with temptation, and there are going to be times when you're going to fall. And God in His Word has made provision for that. Now, turn with me to 1 John. And I know that I've been hammering on this particular verse a lot. We've studied through 1 John recently. You know, we've referenced it several times as we're going through other passages and portions of Scripture. But probably the greatest definition for God's view of sin, and I think it reflects what He's saying in Leviticus chapter 4 and chapter 5, is found here in 1 John verse 8 on through 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 on down through chapter 2, about verse 2. Now, I want you to see this. Because here's what the enemy does. When you sin, he comes and says, hey, listen, if you really were a believer, if you really were a Christian, you wouldn't have done that. How many have heard that voice? What's wrong with you? I don't know that you're saved. Why do you keep falling into the same sin over and over and over again? Why don't you just give up? God doesn't want anything to do with you. You ever heard that voice? Now, come on, don't get quiet tonight. Have you ever heard that voice? Yes, I've heard it. I hear it all the time. That's not the voice of your Father. The voice of your Father is this voice. There is now therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sin be as scarlet, it can be as white as snow. Though it be as wool, you know, crimson, it can be as wool. You know, where are your accusers? I don't know, Lord. Neither do I accuse you. Go now and sin no more. What you find in the voice of your Father is grace and mercy and forgiveness. What you find from the heart of your Father is acceptance and restoration. And God, in His Word, already presupposes that the one who has consecrated his heart to the Lord, the one who has offered the service of his hands, offered the inner recesses of his heart in these offerings to the Lord, is going to struggle. Here's what it says in 1 John. And again, you know, this is by way of reminder. You've heard it. I want you to hear it and hear it and hear it again. You know, one of the things I learned when I was in Bible college, that you need to hear something at least three times before it soaks in. Can you imagine that? Some of us, a little longer. Verse 8 says, if we say, now I want you to see the context of this. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. What is being said there by John in this epistle of his is if you say that you don't have the propensity or the bent to sin. There are some denominations and some churches that will teach you, some Christians actually believe, when you get saved, you become sinless. And there's other denominations that talk about the second work of grace, that once you arrive to that point, you become sinless. The Bible knows nothing of that. What the Bible knows is that you're going to struggle the moment you get saved, the moment that you are born again, the moment that you are regenerated by the Spirit of God and you become a child of God, that very moment you begin a warfare that's going to last for the rest of your life. Now, I have good news and bad news. What do you want first? The bad. The bad is you're going to struggle. We're going to see that tonight. You know what the good news is? One day it's going to end. You know what the bad news is? You got to die for that to happen. And we just want to be real with the Word. And here he says, so if you say, and every one of us have a bent, every one of us have a tendency. You know, that's what Paul was saying. He said, you know, when I want to do good, evil is present. And things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. The things I want to do, I don't. Oh, wretched man that I am. Paul was declaring to us the struggle of the born-again one. And you know it well, don't you? And I know it well. We all know it well. If you've been a Christian more than a day, you know the struggle. You know that there is a traitor in you. And you know that he wants out, the flesh man. That's what Paul was saying, that I myself, that is the with my heart, the spirit man, I serve the law of God, but there's this other guy, this flesh man. Then he says this, John does, but if we confess our sin, again, that word is homologeo. That means to agree with the Holy Spirit and agree with the word that what we've done is wrong. That's coming and reasoning together with the Lord. That's what he wants. If we confess it, he's just and faithful, and he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But if we say what we're doing is not sin, that's the idea in verse 10, then we're a liar and the truth is not in us. You can only get forgiveness, and there's a process, as we're going to see tonight, there's a process that needs to take place for that forgiveness to happen. But if you say that what you're doing is not sin, you never go through the process. Then John says this in chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. That is the standard, isn't it? That's the lofty goal that every one of us should aspire to. The passion and desire of your heart tonight and my heart this evening ought to be sinless. I don't want to sin. And if John ended there, I'd be a little depressed. But he goes on and he says this. And if any man sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. He didn't expiate your sin. And some would say that that means expiation, and it doesn't. Do you know what expiation means? To pay for something. You know, if Doug Lowenstein was hot riding his motorcycle and he ran into my Shelby in the parking lot, I'll use him as an example. He's sitting there big and bold. And I've seen him hot rod his motorcycle. And he runs into my Shelby in the parking lot. And he comes up and he says, Pastor Mike, man, I'm sorry I ran into your Shelby, but man, I'm steaming. I mean, there's some emotion cooking in me. I mean, come on, you were stupid out in the parking lot spinning Brody's and you ran into my car. He said, I'll pay for it, no problem. Now, I can take it down there and have it fixed and he can pay for it. That's expiation, but I can still be upset with him because he ran into my car. But propitiation means not only did he pay for it, but he satisfied any emotion that God would have concerning you that is negative. He propitiated your sin so that God is at peace with you. He has nothing against you. You're not only forgiven and the debt has been paid, but God is at peace with you. He loves you. There's nothing between you and him. That's why in Romans chapter 5, this is having been justified by faith, we have peace with God. Not just the peace of God, we have peace with God. God will never be angry with us again because of the sacrifice of Christ. Now, in the Old Testament, what did they do with their sin? Christ hadn't come and died yet. All of this is type and shadows of Christ coming. But here's what they were to do, and let's read it together, starting in chapter 4 of Leviticus, verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a soul shall sin through ignorance. The idea there is not that you didn't know, but it's unintentionally. You know, your heart is right before the Lord. And listen, every Christian's heart ought to be right before the Lord. And your desire and passion ought to be sinless. But like Paul said, when I want to do good, evil is present. And the things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. The things I shouldn't, you know, the whole thing. This is unintentional. You're doing your best. And by the way, sin in the Greek means to miss the mark. You're still drawing the bow back carefully. You're taking careful aim. You want to hit the target, but you miss. It still needs to be dealt with. In a few moments, we'll look at trespass. That's a whole different thing. But if the soul sins through an unintentional matter, the idea is, against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning the things which ought not to be done and shall do against them. And now he's going to mention four different kinds of people and four different sacrifices that need to be brought to settle the issue of sin. Now notice, firstly, he deals with the priest that is anointed. Then he's going to deal with the whole congregation. Now listen carefully as we read verse 3. And in the King James, it reads a little different than the Hebrew means it to read, and I'll unpack that in a moment. But let's read it. If the priest that is anointed... Now, God has set up spiritual leaders, and Listen, the spiritual leaders, their job was to pray for the congregation. Their job was to mediate between God and the people. Their job was to be an example to the people. Their job was to speak for the Lord to the people. They held a high position because they represented God to the people. But they're not perfect. They're still men. Anointed men. Men called out from among the congregation of the nation of Israel to be priests unto God, to be a part of the Levitical priesthood. But they're still men. They still have men's tendencies. The best of men are still men. And he says, if the priest that is anointed do sin according to the sin of the people. You know, what we would think when we read that in the English is that they sin the same way that the people are sinning, but it really doesn't mean that. In the Hebrew, it has a little different sense. It has a sense that they bring guilt upon the people. Their sin leads the congregation, as we're going to see in a few moments, into sin. One of the examples we have of that is, you remember while Moses was on the mountain and Aaron was down there as the leader, and the people came to Aaron and said, as for this Moses, we don't know what's happened to him. Listen, make us a God that we might serve, that we could say who brought us out of Egypt. And Aaron said, bring me all your earrings and nose rings, bring me your gold and your jewelry. And he fashioned a calf, and he caused the people to sin against God in a drunken orgy around that calf. Listen, priests and pastors have the potential to lead a whole congregation into sin. And so if that one who is to represent God, the one is to put his hand on God and put his hand on people, the one who is to be an intermediary, the one who is to be the voice and the mouthpiece for God, if he sins, and he causes the people to follow him in his sin, because as go the spiritual leaders, so go the people. He says, if he sins, and then he says this, then let him bring for his sin, which he has sinned, a young bullock without blemish unto the Lord as a sin offering. The cost of sin of a priest was a bull. The cost of the congregation, we're going to see in a moment, was a bull. And that was probably one of the most costly things that you had in your possession. You know, today if, you know, we talk about the price of a bull, that would be like saying that you bring your brand new car and you sacrifice it. There's a cost to it. Now, when we get to the rulers and the common people, the rulers are allowed to bring a male goat or a male lamb, and the common people are allowed to bring a female goat or a female lamb, and if they can't afford that, they're allowed to bring a pigeon or a dove, and if they can't afford that, they're allowed to bring flour and oil and frankincense, because God doesn't want his people not coming and getting things right when they sin. But when it comes to the priest, the one who's to represent God, there's a high cost. He's held to a higher standard. There's a high cost. It's not that his sin can't be forgiven. It's not that he can't be restored, but there's a high cost to it. Now watch this. He is to bring a bullock, and he is to offer this bullock without blemish for a sin offering before the Lord. And verse 4 says, he shall bring the bullock unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord, and shall lay his hand upon the bullock's head and kill the bullock before the Lord. It's the idea of he's transmitting his sin into that bull, and that bull, is as the sacrifice, is shedding his blood for the sin of that priest. And the priest that is anointed, verse 5, shall take the bullock's blood. Now watch this. There's a different application to the sacrifice of the priest and the whole congregation than there is to the rulers of the people, the civil leaders, and the common person. And I think this is very interesting when we unpack this. Watch this. The priest that is anointed shall take of the bullock's blood and bring it to the tabernacle of the congregation. Verse 6, and the priest shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle the blood 7 times, which is the number of completion, before the Lord, before the veil of the sanctuary. Now, when a ruler, a civil leader sins, who's been given charge of civil government, or when a common person sins, their blood of that sacrifice that they bring is never taken into the sanctuary. It's offered at the brazen altar. Everything happens outside. but for the anointed priest and for the congregation as a whole, what is required is a bull has to be sacrificed. That priest has to dip his finger in the blood of that sacrifice, and seven times he sprinkles it on this beautifully ornate embroidered curtain that separates the holy from the most holy. It separates the presence of God from the people. And so every time that priest goes in, and this curtain that he in the place he's to do this is right before the table of incense where prayer is to be offered. So every time that priest goes in there, he sees the blood on that veil that separates him from God, and he understands that sin separates us from God. And I have to be an accurate representative to the people of what sin does. My sin, as I led the people into sin, separated the people from God, and there's a consequence, an awful consequence, and it's the blood of that bull ox. And every time I look at that beautifully ornate curtain that separates me to the presence of God, I see the blood seven times splattered on it that I left there. And then after he gets done dipping his finger and putting the blood on the veil, verse 7 says, the priest shall put the blood upon the horns of the altar of sweet incense. That's that table of prayer with the four horns. It's before the veil that incense and prayer were to be offered. And every day they were going in to burn incense and pray for the people. And every evening they came in the same thing. And so every time that priest came in to offer prayer, he saw the blood of the sacrifice for his sin on the four corners of the altar. And it reminded him that, listen, sin, it affects our prayer life. You know, when I ask people how much time you spend in prayer, oh, not much. You know, to me, that's a direct reflection of what's going on in your heart. Because sin will keep you from prayer. But prayer will keep you from sin. When the priest would look down as he would begin to light the incense, he'd see the blood on the four corners of that altar, and it would be a reminder to him that sin keeps you from prayer. It breaks fellowship. Not only can I not go into the presence of God, and blood has to be shed for me to be able to go beyond that veil, but it separates me in my communication, my intimacy with the Lord, so the blood has to be put there. And then he says this in the rest of verse 7, which is in the tabernacle congregation, and he shall pour the blood of the bullock at the bottom of the brazen altar. Now that's outside, because that's where the blood had to be offered for the remission of sin, there at the burnt altar, the brazen altar, of the burnt offering, which is at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. So he offers that blood to the Lord. And when that is done, eight times in the book of Leviticus we find, and it shall be forgiven him. Three times in chapter 4, four times in chapter 5, and one time in chapter 6. We're going to see it in a few moments. Once that is done, God declares, and it shall be forgiven him. What is this whole process to remind us of? And he's going to repeat it again with the whole congregation. He's going to repeat it again, and we'll kind of read through it kind of quickly with the rulers. He's going to repeat it again. It's kind of the same process, a little different procedure, but the same process. He's going to repeat it with the common person. But what is trying to be communicated is that every one of us are going to have a propensity to sin, and the Bible presupposes that you're going to sin. But God has a way to fix sin. But we don't want that way to fix sin to be taken for granted. So what did God prescribe to the priest, the one who had to lead the people? He said, listen, you, because you have sinned, the anointed priest, that blood is going to be on that veil for you to see until it's gone. And I don't know how long that takes for blood to actually dry up and go, but until it's gone, you're going to be reminded. You're going to be reminded that it separates you from the presence of God. You're going to be reminded that it breaks fellowship in the prayer life. And you're going to be reminded that there was a cost that had to be paid. An innocent bull had to die, and his blood had to be shed upon an altar to remove your sin. There is a price to it. So don't take it lightly. Although there's a process and a means to remove it, there's still a cost involved with it. And you need to be reminded about that is what God is saying to Moses to say to the anointed priest. Now, we come to the congregation in a few moments. Let's read on. But then it's going to tell us how to offer this bullock. Verse 8, and you shall take off from it the fat. Remember, the peace offering had to do with the inner parts, because really sin begins in the heart. The heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. You know, when Paul was still struggling with being a Judaizer, he thought that if he didn't commit the outward act, he was okay. And he said, then I read that thou shalt not covet, and sin was revived in me, and I died. He realized at that moment that sin was something that happens in the heart. That's why Jesus said, if a man looks and lusts after a woman in his heart, he's committed the act of adultery already. If he has hatred in his heart, he's committed the act of murder already. What he's saying, it's in your heart. So the things that are sacrificed for the sin offering are the things that are inside, the inner parts of this animal. Let's read it. And he shall take off from all of the fat of the bullock for the sin offering, the fat that covered the inwards, the fat that covers upon the inwards, the two kidneys, the fat that covers upon the flanks, the caul, those fat nodules that are above the liver and the two kidneys. He shall take it away, and it was taken off from the bullock and sacrificed of a peace offering, and the priest shall burn it upon the altar of burnt offering. And so not only the blood has been for the shedding of sin, but now we have a peace offering, and God will be at peace with us again, be at peace with those priests again. But watch verse 11. But the skin of the bullock, that was the expensive part. Leather hides were expensive. And what he's saying here, there should be no profit in sin. And so he says, now you take the expensive part that you think is left over that you don't have to offer to the Lord. The skin of the bullock and all of the other parts of the flesh, the head and the legs and the outwards and the dung and all of that, even the whole bullock shall be carried without of the camp, outside of the camp, unto a clean place where the ashes are poured out, and you shall burn it with fire. Where the ashes are poured out, you shall burn it. You get no profit from sin. You don't get to keep the profitable parts. They're gone. And when that is done, when you've come before the Lord and you brought that sacrifice. Now, in the New Testament, our sacrifice is Christ, just like we said, if we confess our sin. But once that is done, the priest was declared clean. And it shall be forgiven him. It won't be held against him. He has been declared clean. Just like you and I. Now, whole congregation, let's read quickly, it's almost the same process. And if the whole congregation sins, if the priest leads the whole congregation into sin and they follow him into sin, through an unintentional way, they don't mean it, but they still fall into it, and the thing be hid from their eyes and the assembly which they have done, somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning the things which should not be done, and are guilty, then the sin which they have sinned against it shall be known, and the congregation shall offer a young bullock for the sin and bring it to the tabernacle of the congregation. And now the elders, that represents the spiritual life of those people. So, you know, if for whatever reason the leadership of this church caused this church to deviate from the Word of God, and we led you into something that God did not prescribe for you to be in, and that thing became known to us, then all of the elders would gather together with the congregation. We'd go to the tabernacle of meeting. Pastor Aaron and Pastor Tim and Pastor Jason, Max, Gary, and Jim, myself included, we'd put our hands on the bullocks as a representative for you. We'd confess what we have done. We have sinned. We've led this congregation maybe into accepting things that were unacceptable to the Lord, or doing things that were unacceptable to the Lord, or being a part of things that we should never have been a part of. We would confess that as the leadership. The bull would be shed, and the whole process, the blood would be taken inside again, and it would be placed upon the veil. It would be placed upon the four corners of the post of the table of incense, and then the rest of the blood would be taken out, poured out there before the altar of burnt offering, and the rest of that bullock would be taken out of the camp, and it would be burned. And when that process had been completed, then God would say, and it shall be forgiven them. Then you come to verse 22. Now, this is a little different, and that's why we want to read every verse of it. And when a ruler, you know, God has ordained civil government, those people that were to police the place, those people that were just to rule in the civil matters. If a ruler hath sinned and done somewhat through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord his God concerning the things which should not be done, and he is guilty, or if he sins wherein he has sinned, comes to knowledge, he shall bring an offering of a kid goat, a male, it could be a male lamb or a male goat, without blemish. He shall lay it in the hand, his hands upon the head of the goat, and he shall kill it in the place that they kill the burnt offering before the Lord. It is a sin offering. Again, he confesses what he's done, but this is outside of now the tabernacle. This is done there at the altar, burnt offering. The throat is slit, the blood is poured out, the lamb is laid upon that burnt offering, and the priest shall dip his finger, verse 17, in some of the blood, sprinkle it seven times before the Lord and before the veil, and he shall put some of the... Wrong page. I'm thinking, wow, I just taught you wrong. But no, verse 25, and the priest shall take of the blood. Man, that's funny because it says that the priest shall take of the blood on verse 17 and verse 25 at the top of both... my Bible. I'm going to have to mark that up a little bit. And the priest shall take of the blood of the sin offering with his finger and put it upon the horns of the altar, that is the brazen altar outside of the tabernacle, and pour out the blood at the bottom of the altar of burnt offering, and he shall burn all of the fat on the altar as the fat of the sacrifice of the peace offering, and the priest shall make atonement for him as concerning his sin. And here it is for the first time, chapter 4, verse 26. And it shall be forgiven him. You know, when you read through this and all of the typology and all of the analogy and symbolism, what you need to understand is our God wants, it is his heart to forgive you. The Bible presupposes even of the one who loves the Lord with all of his heart, even the one who has dedicated his life and every part of his inner being to the Lord, is going to struggle with sin. The priest, the whole congregation, the rulers, God has provided a means by which, and this is the type of it in the Old Testament, the reality of it in the New Testament is Christ. And then he says this, verse 27, and if any one of the common people, that's just the guys out in the congregation, sin unintentionally, while he doth somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning the things he ought not to have done, and he be guilty, and if his sin, which he has sinned, comes to his knowledge, then he shall bring an offering of a kid goat, a female without blemish, for the sin offering which he has sinned. And he shall lay his hands again, it's that transfer of sin upon this sacrifice, just like our sin was transferred upon Christ. You know, the Bible says that God put our sin upon him. There's the transfer upon the head of the sin offering, and slay the sin offering in the place of the burnt offering. And the priest shall take again the blood with his finger. He's going to put it on the horns around of the bronze altar there, the burnt offering. And he's going to pour the blood out at the altar. And he shall take away all of the fat from it, and the fat that is taken away, offer the sacrifice of the peace offering, and the priest shall burn it upon the altar for a sweet savor unto the Lord, and the priest shall make atonement for him. And again we read, and it shall be forgiven him. The sin has been removed. And if he bring a lamb for the sin offering, he shall bring it of the female without blemish. Again, it's the laying on the hands, the slaughtering of the lamb, the priest offering the blood upon the horns of the burnt altar there, the bronze altar, pouring the blood out before the Lord. And it's the sacrifice. And again, we read there in the last part of verse 35 of chapter 4, and it shall be forgiven them. Again, what we need to see from the scripture is sin is an awful thing. It's a horrible thing. It's something that John tells us, as we just read in 1 John, that we should strive never to be a part of, never to be involved in. I write unto you, John said, that you sin not. That should always be the standard. We never want, just because we're under grace, to lower the standard. Because sin still has an awful price to it. And it has consequences with it. Now, for us in the New Testament, Jesus has paid the price, has he not? But nonetheless, Jesus had to suffer and die for our sin. And his blood was being poured out. It's like the blood of that innocent bull being poured out by the bronze altar. It cost him his life for our sin. Should never be taken lightly. And then we understand it is sin that keeps us from the presence of God. And it's sin that breaks fellowship with God so that our prayer life is hindered. And once we have sinned, there's a process now. This is what Leviticus chapter 4 is telling us. There's a process now by which you can come and be clean again. But you have to be willing to go through the process. And it's going to cost you something. For the priest and for the whole congregation, it costs them a bull. For the rulers, it costs them a male goat or a male lamb. For the common person, a female goat or a female lamb. And if they couldn't afford that, there was still a cost to it. They had to bring a pigeon or a turtle dove. And if they couldn't afford that, they had to bring something, flour and oil and frankincense. There was a cost to it. But there was a procedure by which, if they were willing to go through, they could be forgiven. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, I struggle with sin. That must shock you. I struggle with it. I struggle with the flesh. And in the time we're living in, I realize that those struggles are being magnified by the spiritual warfare, because Satan also knows that his time is short. That's why Paul said in the last days there would be perilous times. Listen, there would be a falling away from the biblical faith. There's going to be this intense warfare that takes place. And while you're in the middle of it as a one who loves God, who has no intention of sinning against him, whose passion is to be sinless, to serve the Lord, not only with your hands, but with your heart, because you've given your life to him, you've been consecrated by him, you're born again. You have an enemy. And the Bible says that, you know, he's a strategist. When the Bible says, beware of the wiles of the devil, that word stratagem in the Greek, we get almost as a direct transliteration in English, the word strategy. He is strategizing against you. Just like Peter, you remember when Jesus said, Peter, Satan has asked for you by name that he might crush you like wheat, that he might grind you up, but I'm praying for you. And before the cock crows, you're going to fail me, Peter. You're going to deny 3 times that you ever knew me. But when, not if, when you come to your senses and repent, then I will restore you and you do what I called you to do. You continue to strengthen the brethren. Peter, you're an apostle. And it shall be forgiven. You know, the problem is I don't think we so much wrestle with God's forgiveness as forgiving ourselves. Because the devil wants you to be in condemnation. He wants you to feel guilt and he wants you to feel shame. He wants you to be in the shadows. That's where he lurks. That's where he does his work. And what we want to know from this study this evening is this. The Bible presupposes to the one who loves the Lord that he's going to fail. And God, in the sacrifices, in the first 5 chapters of Leviticus, as the Levitical priesthood is being established, in the first 5 offerings ordained by God through Moses to the priesthood, the first 3 are not prerequisites. They're offerings that you bring as a free will offering. But listen, the last 2 are mandatory because it presupposes if you are loving the Lord, you're going to struggle with sin. And from time to time, you're going to fall. Now, let's read on, because when we come to chapter 5, we'll go quickly through chapter 5 because there's not much more we can glean or learn, but but we're going to talk about the trespass. But chapter 5, it says, and if the soul sins, and there's several things he's going to talk about that are sin, that are very important to the character, our character. And he says this in verse 1, and if the soul sins, and you hear the voice of swearing, and you are a witness, whether you have seen it or know about it, if you do not utter it, then you shall bear his iniquity. Now, there's a lady in my office today, you know, Tracy, she's been reading ahead in Leviticus, and she had a lot of questions. She goes, some of that, like, man, it's just confusing. What is he saying? He's saying this. If you hear or witness something that's going on between two people, and let's say it goes to court, and you know about it, you know who started the fight, you know what ensued after the fight, you knew who threw the first blow, you knew the whole thing. You witnessed it, or you know, you heard from an eyewitness. If you don't step forward and give testimony, then you're going to be found guilty and you'll have to bring a sin offering. What is God saying? It's not enough not to lie. What is required of the believer is to tell the whole truth. You know, when you go before court and you put your hand on the Bible, I don't know if they do that anymore. Do they do that anymore, Gary? They used to make you put your hand on the Bible and swear. And what you swore is that you would tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. That's what's being said here. Don't bear false witness. Be honest. It's not enough not to lie. You need to be absolutely truthful about everything. God wants his people to be honest. Secondly, verse 2 says, the soul that touches an unclean thing. And there's several things as we go through here he's going to talk about that can make you ceremonially unclean. You touch an unclean animal that's dead, it'll make you ceremonially unclean. If you touch a body, you know, that's dead, a dead person, it'll make you unclean. And you have to bring there an offering to cleanse that. And then when he comes to verse 4, he says, or if the soul swears pronouncing with his lips to do evil or to do good, whatsoever that man has pronounced with an oath, and if it be hid from him when he knoweth it, he shall be guilty of these things. What's he saying? Let your yes be yes and your no be no. If you have made a vow. Now this is interesting that he talks about honesty. Correct? He talks about not being ceremonially unclean. There are things that can taint us. Stay away from those things. And then he talks about here that if you make a vow, did you make wedding vows? It's a vow. Did you promise to come down here on Saturday on a work day at the church and didn't show up? That's a vow. And if you didn't show up, God says you're guilty. Because your yes wasn't yes and your no wasn't no. And you have to pay for that. In fact, God says you're going to add a fifth. There's a whole process of paying for that. But what God is saying is, don't promise something if you're not willing to do it. Why? Because it goes to your character. God wants his people to be honest. God wants his people not to touch unclean things. God wants his people to be people that are people of their word. They keep their word. And then verse 5 says, and if it shall be when that guilty one of these things shall confess that he has sinned in these things, then he shall bring that trespass offering or that sin offering of a female of the flock, of a lamb, of a kid, of a goat, for the sin offering to the priest for the atonement concerning the sin. And if he is not able to bring a lamb, then he shall bring for the trespass offering, then he shall commit two turtle doves, and if he can't do that, two pigeons before the Lord, or for the sin offering as the burnt offering. And verse 8 says, and he shall bring them unto the priest, and he shall offer them for the sin offering, first the wings, and he's going to tell us how he breaks them apart and does all this stuff. And he shall sprinkle the blood upon the altar of the sin altar. And the whole idea, when he goes through this process, at the end of it, and if he can't afford the turtle doves or the pigeons, then he brings, you know, oil and frankincense or whatever. But there's a cost to that. And he brings it, and then we read in verse 13, and it shall be forgiven him. And then we come to the last part of our study tonight, the trespass. And there is a difference between sin and trespass. Again, you and I can sin, not desiring to sin, just doing our best not to sin, but sin. The idea is that it's unintentional. You get in traffic, I'll use myself, and someone cuts you off, and you had no intention to lose your temper. You know, you were doing swimmingly well. You just came out of the presence of God in prayer that morning. You went in and took a shower. You got all ready. You headed to church, man. You were flying high. You were in the heavens. You were in cloud nine. And some blue-haired lady pulls out in front of you. She said she was sorry three times. And you just go, and then, man, all of a sudden you're jerked out of the heavens. You're in the flesh. You didn't mean to do it, but you sinned. Or you're driving down the road, man, and you're having a wonderful time with the Lord, and some gal at the crosswalk walks in front of you, jiggling and shaking everything that could be jiggled and shaken, not wearing enough clothes to make leggings for a jackrabbit, and some thought hits your mind, and you go, oh, Lord, I didn't ask for this. I'm just trying to get to work. Or you wives lose your temper with your husband. You know, he pushed a button that shouldn't have been pushed. And you lose it. That's sin. You still have to own it. In the Old Testament, there was a cost to it. In the New Testament, there is too. There's called repentance. And I'm going to share with you before we end our study tonight what repentance really looks like. But trespass is when it's a willful act. It's when you give yourself over to the thing as an act of your will. It's not an accident. You predetermined, it's premeditated. I'm going to do that. Do Christians do that? Yeah, they do. But then he says this, verse 15, if a soul commits a trespass and sins through, the word there is ignorance, because, and the reason why he puts this is because even the world will say, well, I didn't know that I was trespassing. That's no excuse. What God is trying to put here on the trespass is ignorance is no excuse. You should know. That's the idea here. You should know. Especially as a child of God, you should know. Correct? You have the Holy Spirit living in you. You have the Word of God that's been given to you for instruction. You should know. Nobody's going to stand before the Lord and say, on that day, if they're judged for their trespass because they haven't repented, I didn't know. No, no, no. I gave you a measure of faith. Listen, the Holy Spirit was there even among the unbelievers, convicting you of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. You should have known. If a soul commits trespass and sins through ignorance in the holy things of the Lord, then he shall bring for his trespass unto the Lord a ram without blemish of the flocks, with an estimate of a shekels of silver after the shekels of the sanctuary for the trespass offering. This has a special price to it because it was a willful act. And he shall make amends for the harm that he had done in the holy things. He shall add fifth part unto it and give it unto the priest, and the priest shall make atonement for him with the ram of the trespass offering, and it shall be, again we read that, forgiven him. Now, what are some of the things we can trespass in? How many know? Well, no, I don't even go there. I don't have time to go there. I would go there, but I won't. I don't need to talk to you about trespass. You know what trespass looked like, don't you? Okay, I'm going to go there. If you men know that you are to love your wife unconditionally, you have commandment of the Lord, you're a believer, you know that, and you don't, that's not a sin. That's a trespass. If you wives know that you're to give unconditional respect to your husbands because the Word of God declares it, and you don't, that's a trespass. Children, obey your parents. When they don't, that's a trespass. They know it from the Word of God. It's not something unintentional. Especially when it becomes habitual. You understand? It's a trespass. It's an act of the will. God has commanded you to do something that you willfully do not do. Now, it can be forgiven you. In the Old Testament, here we are declared that it can be forgiven, but there was a special cost to it. It wasn't just the ram. You had to bring silver, which is the money of redemption. You had to bring it to make amends The priest would take it and make atonement, verse 16, and you shall be forgiven. And if a soul sins and commits any of these things which are forbidden to be done by the commandment of the Lord, though he knew it not, yet he is guilty and shall bear his iniquity. There's no excuse for ignorance. In fact, I don't know if that's still the law of the land, Gary, but ignorance is no excuse for the law, correct? You still have to know what it says. He shall bring a ram without blemish out of the flock with the estimation, or that's with the silver of, you know, for the redemption of that sin, for a trespass offering unto the priest, and the priest shall make atonement. That means to make atonement. He makes atonement for him concerning his ignorance wherein he erred, whether he knew it or not. And again, we read those words, it shall be forgiven him. It is a trespass offering. He has certainly trespassed against the Lord. So, you know, when we come to chapter 4 and 5, and you go, man, the last thing I want to talk about when I come to church is sin. I don't want to talk about trespass. I don't want the pastor to beat me up. Well, listen, I'm not beating you up. What I'm telling you is the Bible presupposes that you're going to mess up. Did you know that? And it has provision in it for when you mess up. Now, in the few moments that I have left, in fact, get Jason and Ann to come on up while I'm saying this, so we can speed it up a little bit. I don't want the people in the children's ministry to be upset with me. Here's what I want you to know about repentance. We don't have to bring a ram or a bull or a lamb or a goat or a turtle dove or a pigeon. We don't have to bring oil or flour or frankincense. We don't need to go down because there's no tabernacle anymore and go to the priest there and offer these things. These were shadows of the real that was to come. Christ is that. But when we sin, we are called to repentance. And can I share with you just quickly in a moment what that should look like in your life? Can I do that? Because repentance isn't, I'm sorry. Now, if the sin that you have committed is between you and the Lord and nobody else, then it can be dealt with privately, and I believe there's a process that should be followed in that. If you have sinned against your brothers or sisters in Christ or somebody else, then you need to go make amends. And what that looks like, let me say first, if for whatever reason, you know, Jeff comes over to my house and I lose my temper at Jeff Wagnett and I start screaming and yelling at him, and maybe I pick up a 2x4 and I smack him upside the head and I call him everything but a child of God, and we roll around in the parking lot for a while, and it's all my fault. I don't just get to say to the Lord, Lord, forgive me. You know, I didn't know what I was doing. No. I have to go to Jeff. And I have to say to Jeff, Jeff, what I did was wrong. Now, I'm going to get it right with the Lord, absolutely. But my sin involved you. What I did was wrong. No excuse for it. I hurt you. I hurt your feelings. I damaged our relationship. That's on me. I did this. And what I'm asking you to do is to forgive me, and whatever it costs to get your eye put back in your head and the scars, you know, removed and the face sewn up from me hitting you with a 2x4, I'm going to pay for it. And I promise you, with God's help, I will never do that again. Would you forgive me? That's repentance. And if we sin against the Lord, I think it looks like this. Father, I have violated your law. Whether unintentionally or willfully, I have sinned against you. And I want you to know that I am sorry. Father, it's not in my heart to violate your law. I don't want to. And so I'm asking you to forgive me. I have no excuse for it. I did it. And then I say this to Jesus. Jesus, forgive me. The second person of the Trinity. Because my sin cost you. My sin put those stripes on your back. My sin put that crown of thorns on your head. My sin nailed you to that cross. My sin put that spear in your side. You suffered and died because of my sin, and I don't take it lightly, and I'm asking you to forgive me for thinking so lightly of your sacrifice that I would love my sin more than I love you. I do this. And then I go to the Holy Spirit and I say, Holy Spirit, the third person of the Godhead, I grieved you and I quenched you and I didn't listen. Because had I been listening, I would have never done what I just did. And I'm asking you to forgive me. In fact, I'm asking for more of you, that you would wash me and cleanse me and fill me so that I won't do that anymore. And I know that when I leave that place of repentance, that I am forgiven. And I don't let the enemy mess with my head. And it shall be forgiven them, God declared. Now, sometimes, you know, I really feel bad. And 5 minutes later, I said, Lord, I really want you to know that I really was sorry about that thing I did. And he goes, what thing? Because God doesn't just forgive, he forgets. He refuses to put sin on your account. But the standard should always be to sin not. But if you do, John says, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus the righteous, who propitiated your sin. Get it right with him. Come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sin be as scarlet, I can make it as white as snow. Though it be as crimson, I can make it like wool. If you will confess your sin, he is just and faithful to forgive you and cleanse you. And again, the Bible presupposes that we're going to have difficulty. Anybody have that? Only me, right? Let's stand. And Chris ends from church. Let's stand. I hope that helps you some as we're working our way through Leviticus. It is the order of the priest, and it is the job of the priest to intercede for sin. But listen, how many have sinned this week? How many confessed your sin? How many got alone and got it right with the Lord? Then what you need to know tonight is you're forgiven. You're forgiven. Now move on. And don't do your best not to do it again. But what if you do it again the next day? Then you go through the same process, don't you? And when you're done with that process, what does God say? Hey, I forgave you yesterday. Of that, I'm not forgiving you today. Is that what he says? No. Listen, saint, he says, and it shall be forgiven. Our God is gracious and merciful, kind and forgiving beyond what we could ever imagine. Amen. Let's worship.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you, Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
Amazing love.
Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Amazing love, one more time, church.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know is true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you.
You know, Father, as we close our service tonight, I just feel led to pray for the one who is struggling tonight. And Lord, their heart is to serve you. They truly do love you with all of their heart. Lord, they've consecrated their life to you. They're born again. They are blood-bought, blood-washed, spirit-filled. And Lord, they want to serve you. And they want to give you not only the outward parts, but the inward parts of who they are, the secret parts. And yet, Lord, they have fallen, and the enemy comes, and he tries to whisper into their ears, God doesn't love them. Tries to bring shame and guilt. Lord, I want you to share with them in a very powerful way this week that when they have repented, when they've come and reasoned together with you, when they have homologeo, confessed that it is no longer an issue with you, Lord, that you are just and faithful to cleanse them of all unrighteousness, and there is now therefore no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. And it shall be forgiven them. And then, Lord, strengthen them. Because the great lie of the enemy is for us to continue to fall all the time. And he just beats us up. But strengthen them, Father. That thing would not be an issue for them. Give them strength to be victorious in that area. But let them, Lord, labor from a position of victory, not labor for victory, because they already have victory in you, Father. May they not labor to be forgiven. They are already forgiven. Let them labor from a position of being forgiven, to do what is right, we pray. And all God's kids in agreement with that would say, amen, amen. Hey, we want to ask you to do something tonight. I know that the service went a little long, and it's all Pastor Jason's fault. Just saying, confessing his sin for him before he has to. We need to move the chairs to the side if we can. If you guys can stay and help us do that and get ready for the melodrama that's going to be Saturday. Don't forget, Saturday, 6 p.m. is the dinner. 7 p.m. is the melodrama here at the church. And so you can invite some friends to come as well. It's a fundraiser for Africa. But if we don't want to slide the chairs, we want to stack them up and carry them off to the side.